new species. And in this new species, to diversify the market, flatfishes are very interesting because the public perceives them as a very different, do not compete with the sea bass or possibly with the market, and these are high-priced fish. But the problem is that very few flatfishes are cultured in Europe right now. Basically, there are is one species, which is the turbot, and Spain actually is the maximum producer of this species, but the still is much lower than the salmon or the sea basses or sea bream. And then there is the Senegalese Solea, or the Solea Senegalensis, or Solea, which culture started in the 80s, actually before the sea bream and the sea bass were really developed. But for some reason, nobody wanted to develop this further. And then very few studies were done, mostly only some culture of Solea Solea, but the growth was slow. It's a slow growing fish, so there was not a lot of interest until in the 90s, where the interest for Solea Senegalensis increased again, and in fact now there's a lot of interest in the industry in Spain, and in Portugal, in Spain, and also in Asia, in China, for instance, to culture this fish. This fish, for instance, right now, to tell you, is 18 euro per kilo. They are selling this fish by 18 euros. They agree that Solea Senegalensis is much better because it's a fast-growing fish. So it's
more easy to spawn.
Sorry?
And more easy to spawn.
Okay, I will go into this. So let me go on. Because that's a major problem. So anyway, so Senegalensis, the production is still very low. It's a 60 tons per year, something like that. So it's very low yet. But this is a promising candidate for it has, as I said, it's fast growth and a highly appreciated meat. For instance, just to show you, this company that is producing turbot in Spain, which is Stoll Sea Farm, which actually is a multinational, an Norwegian multinational, is now putting a lot of effort to develop Solea Senegalensis culture, and started a hatchery in France and different farms to grow Solea Senegalensis in Alita. So it's so industry really wants to develop. But what is the major problem of this fish? Of course, there is one problem that still we have not faced, which are the disease. Because the production is so low, most of the disease didn't appear yet. So as soon as the industry will develop, probably disease will appear and some specific disease will appear and we'll have to solve. But right now, the major problem is the reproduction, is the control of reproduction in captivity. Most of this production that has been done so far is with wild fish adapted in captivity, and after 3-5 years, they start to spawn naturally. But these spawns are not predictable, and then you cannot control either the quality. So it's very difficult to develop an industry based on this. So one of the objectives is the control of spawning or the reproduction of this fish. This flatfish is also very different than the Solea, than the sea bass or the sea bream. For instance, the females are very similar, are more similar to the sea bream, so are fractional spawners, so they spawn different. Each female spawns maybe 6 or more times per spawn in the season. But the males produce microliters of sperm, microliters, while the sea bass or sea bream produces milliliters of sperm. Okay? So it's a very small sperm, which also has a different pattern of development, like the sea bream or sea bass, which is a semicystic spermatogenesis. So this is quite a usual model of testis development in fish that is present in this Solea Senegalensis. So the larval culture is relatively easy, so it's not a problem, although it can be optimized, but it's not a problem. So the major problem right now is reproduction. So some years ago, although the culture of this fish is still developing, it was an initiative in Spain funded by Genome Spain and Genomics, that as soon as this reproduction problem is solved, that will help to develop the culture quite fast, as you will see. So this project was called Pleurogene. So here, I was the coordinator of this project. And at that time, in 2004, we started to use the old techniques available, and we started to do some sequencing, some EST sequencing with some databases, EST databases. So EST is RNA, so it's a database of RNAs. Like it's written here, and but we produced very few at that time because it was still sample sequencing, so very expensive. We produced about 10,000, and with this data, we synthesized a microarray. Actually, at that time already we saw that oligo microarray was the future, and actually this is an oligo microarray that is available, but unfortunately, of course, it has only 5,000 genes, right? So it was the first microarray developed, and actually I believe it was the first oligo microarray for fish, and this one. And today all our oligo microarray, which has much more, much better. So we synthesized and we designed this microarray. Well, here you see the performance of this microarray at that time, and then we used this microarray for some experiments, and actually people, for instance, did a microarray study during larval development. In my lab, we studied during ovarian development in the females, what were the genes changing to learn about this animal, the physiology of this animal. I mean, it was still a very primitive microarray, but still, we found, for instance, some interesting information during ovarian follicular atresia. We found some genes, actually some quite unexpected, that were upregulated during ovarian follicular atresia. And this, we have not gone further with this, but for instance, we can use this to define markers, biomarkers, to be able to select females, good females for reproduction. Yeah? So this is something that this information has not been used yet, but there are some of these genes, some of these proteins that appear that can be used as biomarkers to select the good females. And actually, this is also applicable for the sea bass or the cypriot, which may be important in a hatchery. So then, the project was finished in 2008. Another project started, which is, I'll show you now, it's called Aquagenet. In this one, they are using the new generation technologies for in Solea Senegalensis, which, well, I'm not going to go again into the details, but this new generation technology basically allows you to have much more information and much cheaper. Sequence information and much cheaper. So it's everybody, what is everybody doing these days? And also, these approaches, especially the biosequences 454 has been mentioned, and even the Illumina, when you have the genome for the species, are very good tools also to study gene expression. Yeah. Macroarrays, for instance, is not the best way, because in a macroarray you already put the genes that you know in advance. So if you want to look for, you want to do some gene discovery and look for new genes, it's better to do deep sequencing. So what is also called RNA-seq, which is the sequence of the transcriptome of a cell. In this way, you can find more unexpected genes or gene discovery. So microarrays are good for diagnosis. And probably in a couple of years, most of the transcriptome for many of the important species for aquaculture will be available. So we may have species-specific microarrays for diagnosis. And this for aquaculture could be a very interesting tool. To see, for instance, from the physiological point of view, how are your fish, or your broodstock, or whatever. So this project actually has used 454, as I said, but also Illumina. And they are doing sequencing the transcriptome of different tissues and also of embryos, and they have started to do the genome sequence. So they are doing they did some back libraries like in the CBAS, and they have started to do some genome sequencing. So hopefully the genome of this fish will be available soon.
Joan, it's for Solea.
So that's the origin, yeah. Yeah. So I mean here, for instance, is the strategy that they are doing, Illumina. Yeah, so they are still working. I mean, they are just starting, but this will be very interesting, at least for some, at least to increase the genetic linkage map, which already we have some, but it's still very small. This is just the tools that are available for the Solea Senegalensis right now. So they have RNA-seq, a microarray. It will be also available soon, and this microarray may contain If our vacuary contained 5,000, this probably will contain 40,000. So this is much better, will be much better. And they're also doing something that's called open array, which is another technique, which you, is to quantify some of the genes, a selected number of genes, you quantify it in a small number. Alright? And this is, and they, for instance, they have built one of these for immunology, to detect immunological response of the Solea Senegalensis. Anyway, and these are the tools that are being developed. And as I said, even though the aquaculture, there are still a lot of practical things that we have to solve, this information is coming, will be coming out. So as soon as these practical things will be solved, we'll have already a lot of genomic information waiting to be used in like for SIVA accessibility. Then in that project that I mentioned, which was called Prerogene, we also did some proteomics. And again, in the old-fashioned way, proteomics in the old-fashioned way was done by gels, and then these are the proteins, and you separate the proteins by weight and by electrical charge, and then you can cut these spots, which are proteins, and then sequence them, and you can know which are these proteins, and you can compare between two physiological states of the fish, and then you can see if one protein increases respect to the other or decreases. But this is old fashioned. Today, as you can see, this can introduce a lot of bias to the analysis. So today, actually, this is not done, and indirectly in a tube, there are machines that measure the protein, the differences in protein, and also sequence the protein for you. So. And this is actually very important because in biology, the genomic era already passed. And now we are in the proteomics era, and to understand how the proteins work. So proteomic technologies will probably be developed very fast now. And this also for aquaculture and for other animal production systems will be very useful tools. Because proteins are the main actors of cell function, okay? The genes code for proteins, so are the proteins the main players of any physiological action. So we want to know the proteins. So, for instance, we did this for the Solea Senegalensis at that time with the old-fashioned way, and this is another technique. you label with fluorescent dyes your proteins, so you can measure better the differences in the quantity. And for instance, we apply this to study. If there were differences between the sperm produced if the spermatogenesis of the animals of F1 animals were different from wild fish, because in Solea Senegalensis one of the problem looks like that the males, the F1 males do not reproduce like wild males. For instance, if you and most of the companies and institutions, they have tried to reproduce males and F1 males and females, and most of the time the eggs are not fertilized. But when you take these females F1 and you cross them with wild males, then you have fertilization. So looks like that the male, there is something, or the maturation of the testes of the F1 males is not correct, or they produce bad sperm, or there is a miscommunication between males and females, and then do not fertilize the eggs. So it's unclear what is going to be. What is clear, and there is a strong communication between males and females in Solea Senegalensis. But animals, this is somehow affected, and then they do not respond. So at that time, we wanted to study by doing proteomics, for instance, in what differences between F1 and wild fish. And we found, for instance, that some mechanisms that could be affected. And some of them are related to the sperm ability for fertilization. So it's possible that in addition to behavioral problems, you have also some physiological problems of the males. But this is still, several groups are working on this, trying to solve this problem. So also, we started at that time, we started a genetic map in Solea Senegalensis. This, for instance, is a genetic linkage map for the turbot, which is this flatfish that is produced a lot in Spain. Actually, this is probably the best flatfish that were there are more genetic resources right now in Europe, and actually they were also recently they were also to identify a marker which it looks like is linked to sex and females in the tumor. In the in the Solea Senegalensis still there is a very small map. I think it has 120 microsatellites or something. But this for new sequencing effort probably will increase much more the genetic link much more. So this will be probably will be ready to be used in a few years. And then so basically, you know, it's more or less are the same techniques that have been applied for sea bass or sea bream, but you need to develop for stress analysis. So these are the state of the art. But before I finish, I'd like to comment something that is it's not genomics, but it's something that is going to be more and more important, I think, in aquaculture and other animal production, which is the use of recombinant hormones, recombinant proteins. So sometimes to obtain a protein or hormone from an animal is so expensive from a live animal is so expensive sometimes it's just impossible. And then we can use molecular biology approaches to produce it in vitro. And then these hormones are equally effective in the animal. And this is especially interesting for the Solea Senegalensis because, as I said, the females, the males and females, F1 have problems for reproduction. So one of the solutions to this could be the artificial fertilization. Like, for instance, it's done in turbot. In turbot, all production is based on artificial fertilization. All. So maybe in Solea Senegalensis, that would be the way to go. But what is the problem? That unlike turbot, Solea Senegalensis produces very few amount of sperm. So in my lab, that is something that we are doing in my lab, is we think that if we are able to develop a system to produce more sperm, we can cryopreserve and use for fertilization, right? So how we can control the amount of sperm that fish produce? By using two hormones, basically, which are the two hormones that control reproduction in fish, which are the gonadotropins. These gonadotropins are produced in the brain of the fish, and at the time of reproduction, they are released into the blood, and they stimulate the gonad to produce a sperm or eggs. What's the problem? That how you can obtain this sort of hormone? You have to sacrifice fish and purify from the brain, right? This is very expensive, and it's time consuming, and it's very expensive. So what is the other approach? It's just to do the hormones in vitro. How? Using cells, human mammalian cells. And this is what we have done in my lab. So basically, and actually this was a consequence of our sequence of the fish in a vector. This is a specific plasmid that you transfer the cells and then start to produce. And then you check in other cells that this medium that secrete that where the cells are, they have the hormone. You test that, and then later you purify this medium by chromatography, and then you have your proteins, your recombinant proteins. Right? These are even better because the gonadotropin actually is two proteins, two subunits, alpha and beta. And these bind and they are active. In this case, we make the trick, yes, which is to synthesize just one protein with the alpha subunit and the beta subunit. And then they can, when you produce the protein, it can interact together. And in this way, the protein is more stable, right? So that's what we did here. The beta, the alpha, and something to allow to join, to fall, right. So, and then we use these hormones in vitro to test the biological potency of this hormone, we tested in vitro, and you see there is a nice production of esteroids in response of this recombinant hormone. And also in vivo, we inject this recombinant into males in vivo, and you see that they respond by producing more esteroids in plasma. So this shows you that we have produced recombinant hormones that are biologically active. The advantage is that we can produce as much as we want. We don't need to sacrifice anything, and because it's the old hormone, because this hormone is the one, is the same that the fish has, does not produce any immunological response. You know that for many fish, to induce sperm production, people use human chorionic gonadotropin or other sources of gonadotropins, but these are very big hormones and proteins that sometimes induce an immunological response to the animal. This is the hormone of the fish, so it's not going to make any antibody, any general response. So this way, now we're going to use this to inject it to males, and then we're going to start soon to evaluate the production of the sperm and the quality of the sperm in a way. And then if we're able to develop this, we may solve this reproduction problem of the Senegalese soil by using artificial fertilization. There are other groups, particularly in Spain, that are trying to understand how this behavior in Solea Senegalensis works, with the idea that in the future you may control better the reproduction. But this is going to be quite difficult, because probably is chemical communication involved in this mechanism, and this is a very tough, and I don't know, so much about this, it's very complicated. So until we're able to identify which is the component that makes the communication, it may be some years. More knowledge about comparative genomics, and also between flatfishes would be interesting. Genetic maps, or, of course, to develop new transcriptome analysis systems to understand how are regulated the physiological processes of the fish, and of course the identification of commercial of traits of commercial interest and the QTLs, etc. And bioinformatics. Bioinformatics is probably the major, one of the most important things going to be needed in the next years to handle all this information, all the sequence information, and make sense of how to do it. And biotechnological approaches, which is not a genomic thing, but it's derived from genomic technologies, and this could be also very useful, at least for some species. No? And that's all. So it's been short.
Okay. Okay. Question for Solea Senegalensis. I know that Linikes in the past used to culture Solea in Greece.
We have the same problem with the males. So every year we have to catch wild males. So we stop it. We produce about 30 tons 5 years ago, but now we destroy the old.